chain, oh God. You have done great things. We dance in your freedom, awakened alive. Oh Jesus, our Savior, your name lifted high, oh God. You have done great things. Jesus, our Savior, your name lifted high, oh God, you have done great things. Hallelujah, God, above it all. Hallelujah, God, unshakable. Hallelujah, you have done great chain, oh God, you have done great things. We dance in your freedom, awakened alive. Oh Jesus, our Savior, your name lifted high, oh God, you have done great things. You have done great things. Oh God, you do great things.
Joining us here in person, good morning. Whether you're joining us online, good morning. It's wonderful to have you all worshiping with us this morning. As we dive back into worship, a lot of the songs that we're singing are talking about the reality of Jesus and his sacrifice and his love for us. The fact that he came from heaven and he died and he rose again and he sits victoriously at the right hand of God the Father. And it is such an encouragement to remember what Jesus did for us. But I felt like the other side of that, the other hand, is to not get lost in what Jesus does in worship, but also to remember who he is. And so I just felt God saying, I am this morning. I am the Alpha and the Omega. I am the beginning and the end. I am your firm foundation, the rock on which you stand. I am the quiet in the storm. I am the joy on the mountaintop. And this morning we get to not only remember what he's done, but who he is and the reality of his presence here with us this morning. So let's pray and dive back into worship. God, thank you that we get to say you are good and your love endures forever, not only because of what you've done, because of your sacrifice, but also because of who you are. It says in Scripture, God is love. And so we just worship the God who is worthy of all the praise and all the glory and all the honor this morning. In Jesus' name, amen.
Who breaks the power of sin and darkness? Whose love is mighty and so much stronger? The King of glory, the King above all kings. Who shakes the whole earth with holy thunder? Who leaves us breathless in awe and wonder? The King of glory, the King above all kings. This is amazing grace. I sing for all that you've done for me.
Oh. Who brings our chaos?
Who brings our chaos back into order? Who makes the orphan a son and daughter? The King of glory, the King above all kings. The nations with truth and justice shines like the sun in all of its brilliance. The King of glory, the King above all kings.
This is
amazing grace. This is unfailing love that you would take my place. You've done for me.
Oh, you're worthy all the praise, all the glory. Thank you, Jesus. Let's sing, worthy is the Lamb.
Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. You've done for me.
Take my place.
Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me. The name above every other name. Jesus, the only one who could ever save.
We sing worthy.
Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. We live for you. Your heart and lead me song we could ever sing. Worthy of all the prayers we could ever bring. Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. We live for you. Jesus, the name above every other name. Jesus, the only one who could ever say.
Worthy.
Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. We live for you.
Jesus, you are the rock on which we stand. You are our firm foundation. You are our strong tower. And God, we ask that your love would be the filter through which we see the world around us, that you would teach us to love like you. We give you all the praise and all the glory and all the honor. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. You can grab a seat. Happy Father's Day. Happy Father's Day to you who are watching online as well. And I think there's a couple of birthdays. Pat Kirtland, Stacy Rice, happy birthday to both of you. Anybody else have a birthday today? What? Matthias's birthday today. He's 8.
Wow.
Awesome. Awesome. Nope. Hey, so throw up the QR code, Stacy. The QR code. So there's two places to find what's going on here at Revive Bitterroot. That is to scan that QR code or to look on the back wall at the chalkboard. That QR code actually takes you directly to an online bulletin, gives you the dates and all the details of that. Thank you to Megan Gessler, who was playing the bass this morning. She's working that out for us. It's a great, but I do want to highlight one thing that's coming up, and that's 4th of July. We are going to have a 4th of July family celebration right out here on the lawn, just north of here. We're going to have two or three huge bouncy houses. We're going to Revive Bitter will provide the meat. If you guys will bring a side dish, lawn chairs, we're going to have lawn games. We're going to have just a great time. It's July 4th from 5 to 8. And then we'll probably go to Florence and watch the fireworks. But if you have another favorite fireworks, like in Hamilton, you guys can go whichever fireworks you like. But that is July 4th here at the church from 5 to 8. So please plan on joining us. It'll be a great celebration. And the kids are going to love it because, again, we're going to have some huge bouncy houses that actually Revive Missoula owns those bouncy houses because we purchased them from a sports facility that used to rent from us, and they didn't want them anymore, so it'll be cool. So I'm actually going to need some guys' muscles to go get them, so we'll everybody looking at me with a bad back, everybody's like, no. Happy Father's Day. All right. Hey, counselors and staff that's going to camp, raise your hand. Actually, stand up. Stand up. Stand up. Stand up. If you're going to camp. All right, let's pray for these guys. After I pray, you're welcome to give your offering in the black box. You can give online as well. But let's pray for these guys that are going to camp. We've got about 110 youth, right? 112? Wow. 112. That means about 170 altogether with support staff and stuff. So there's a lot of people to make this happen. But some really impactful things happen in youth lives. I'm telling you, it's not, there is a lot of fun in games, but there's a lot of times where these guys, the youth, just crash the altar and worship and just avail themselves to the work of the Lord. So be praying all this week, but let's pray for these poor souls that are going. I'm not going this year, so I can say that. I'm actually speaking on Wednesday, but I just have one responsibility. So, Father, thank you so much for these people that are going to camp, that are investing in the lives of our youth, Father. They know how important it is to capture the hearts of our youth. So, Lord, we ask you that you will protect them, that you will give them special insight, give them boldness to speak into the lives of these youth. Lord, even if it's a youth that's standing off to the side or making trouble, help them to have the love and the boldness to go to them, speak to them, and draw them back in to what is happening and draw them back into you, Father. Lord, I ask you that you'll have your way at this camp, that this will be a line drawn in the sand. There'll be many youth that will draw a line in the sand and say, you know what, from now on, I am standing up for God. And I am laying my life down for the Lord. So we just ask you that your hand will be upon this entire week and that great things will come from it and lives will be changed and committed to you, Lord. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. Hey, take about 5 minutes. Say hi to somebody that you don't know. Give somebody a hug if you want to, but and then we'll start back up in 5 minutes.
Can you hear me? Because my mic is on and Stacy was calling you. Can you hear me? Can they hear me?
Not yet.
I already turned it on. Okay, good.
Because I don't want the conversation to go.
Understood. He was calling you.
All right, everyone.
Oh, am I gone?
So you've got a real treat today.
I get an introduction?
You do.
Okay.
You do. So this guy and his family joined us about 18 months ago. Their first Sunday, they showed up and brought an entire entourage with them. It was basically a Californian invasion.
Hold on. That's not true. Because the other two families were from here.
Yes, that's right.
Speak the truth,
you're right,
Pastor.
You're right.
Speak
okay.
the truth.
But from then, it has been just an amazing... They've got such amazing family. I love them so much. And I tapped him on the shoulder about a week and a half ago, said, hey, you want to speak? And he said, yeah, like in August or October? And I said, no, like in 10 days. And so with family in town, he has put his nose to the grindstone and listened to the Lord. And so welcome Matt Roth for me speaking today.
Thank you, sir. You're so sweet. And if I'm picking on you today, it's not personal. So that leads me into, hey, happy Father's Day, everybody. When Stacy called and asked me to speak about Father's Day, I'm like, yeah. Wait, are you sure? I mean, couldn't I talk about like marriage or relationships or, you know, some of my testimonies or, you know, that mission trip I went on where the Holy Spirit just moved? No, Matt, I need to talk on Father's Day. I said, really? All right. Okay, let's try it. I said, well, Stacy, listen, let me, some parameters here. I'm not a good father. I make a lot of errors. And so, like, normally if you have somebody speak on Father's Day, it's somebody like, man, you look up to, and you're like, I want to be like that person one day. So there was a lot of prayer this week on what does he want me to talk about? Not him. Because, you see, I don't have an earthly father. My dad died when I was 7. I have no example of what a good father looks like. I have no example of what a bad father looks like, which is a blessing and a curse, right? I had people going, oh, when I was younger, you know, you're raised by a single mom. No, your dad beats you every night. Your dad does other weird things to you every night. I was okay. I was safe. So I didn't have an earthly father role model. So I'm like, Stacy, what do you want to talk about? Like, have you seen my children? I'm not the best dad. Let's figure this out.
At least Charlie is.
At least Charlie is, right. 50% is not bad if you're a baseball player. I can say that about Jake because he's not here. He's playing baseball in Lewistown right now. And he guaranteed won't watch this recording. You guys all know Jake. Interesting. My dad died when I was 7 in a motorcycle accident, okay? My baby brother died when I was 3 years old. So by the time I was 7, my baby brother was dead, my dad was dead. But it taught me that life is short and we're not promised tomorrow. So my entire upbringing, I'm literally trying to figure out my kids. They're 16 and 17 now. And I'm still trying to figure out how to be a dad, right? How many dads can relate, right? I will try not to keep moms out of this conversation today, but it's really Father's Day, so it's our day, okay? You guys get the other 364 that we cater to you. Amen, right, there we go. Thank you, sir. So what do I know about being a dad? Cliff Huxtable, anybody remember him?
Yeah.
Earthly fathers, right? Everybody want to be like Cliff Huxtable. But in real life, how did Bill Cosby turn out? How about Ward Cleaver? A little bit before my time, but how many guys know Ward Cleaver? I was just saying, some people we were. And unfortunately, I turned out to be more like Phil Murphy. Anybody know Phil? Right? Phil? Yeah. Phil Dunphy. I say, hey, Stacy, I'll give it my best. I'll do what I can, and I'll pray about it. And I prayed about it. And I prayed about it, and I prayed about it, and I prayed about it, and I prayed a lot about it. And it was just really like, hey, listen, okay, let's work through this. So let me start. Before I start, I want to give a disclaimer. About 20 years ago, I was in a seriously bad accident, and I have traumatic brain injury, and it was affected my temporal lobe, which is your emotional center. So if somewhere during this, my allergies kick in, it happens, okay? I'm praying my allergies don't kick in today. But a lot of times when I'm talking about the Lord, it happens. So, all right. Shh. Other parameters, I will try. My goal is to get past 10 minutes, but not past 60. So we're going to aim right between there. I can't look over there because I'll cry. So if I get too long, somebody back here go and just let me know. And because my TBI, I get off track sometimes. So we're going to kind of work through this. So again, I don't have an earthly father. So I go, okay, let's go back to God's guidance. Okay. Even as a child, I always knew there was somebody above. I knew that somebody was watching. I knew when I was reaching into that cookie jar, purse, somewhere, taking something, somebody was watching. And I always kind of felt that my dad was up there with him watching, you know. Dad's probably not up there, but he had a different life. And so I was like, okay, I think we're all born with this moral compass of right and wrong. But I wasn't really brought up a Christian. I was brought up a Catholic. Yeah, it's kind of Christian. I'm just kidding. But even as a young kid, I had trouble with the Catholic religion. Why do I got to go pray to that guy on Fridays? I can talk to God anytime. Like, I knew I could talk to this guy anytime or say, hey, I'm sorry for that, which is usually a lot of apologies. It was, hey, I'm sorry for that too, and whatever. So I always had that feeling of this omnipresence that was around me and guiding my life. I never felt like I didn't have that connection, and it kind of guided me. But I really didn't get a Christian moral compass on a daily basis from family, really, you know, other than my mom. She did an amazing job, if I do say so myself. But knowing that there's some spiritual being out there that's greater than me. And so when I get to high school, I go, hold on, I'm getting ahead of myself. Yeah, so by the time I'm 7, I lose my baby brother, I lose my dad. We talk about that. I knew early that God was there. I knew the difference between right and wrong, good and evil, and love and hate. And I knew, because life is so short, right? I was literally at summer camp when my mom comes up and goes, hey, your dad died. Well, that's cool. I didn't understand the concept at 7. Well, your brother's going to be there. Oh, okay, I'll come back down. I was having so much fun at summer camp. You don't register that at 7 years old. Okay? But as the years go on, you're like, there's no dad. There's no this. Life is quick. So I knew to love more than to hate. I don't hold grudges. I'm over things. I get mad occasionally, rarely. But I'm over things in 20 minutes because you can't stay mad at people because they die. People die. Then I get into first being a responder and being a cop and a paramedic. And those of you guys that have been to war, you guys realize it. People die like that. It just happens. And you don't have to be at war for people to die. I would imagine everybody in this room has lost somebody in their life. So I didn't know the Lord. I knew of an omnipresence, but I didn't know the Lord. I didn't have that relationship with him like we start to have in our Christian church. But he knew me, and he loved me. I know that now. I didn't know that then. And so I could talk with him whenever I wanted. I could ask him for forgiveness. I could tell him I'm sorry. But it wasn't until my adulthood that I began to actually read the Bible and began to know him. He knew me, and I know that now, but I didn't know him. So you start reading the Bible, and you start learning of who he is. So how does this relate to Father's Day? And I'll get there. Hold on. In November of 2003, we received the word, bless you, we received the word that Ryan is pregnant. Uh-oh. And the Lord has blessed us with a child. And after doing the normal notifications of parents and friends, our next step is we got to find a church. Like, literally, that was the conversation Ryan and I had. Maybe we've got to find a church. We're raising these kids to have a good faith. But really, what we were doing was training ourselves to be good Christians. We didn't grow up in Christian households. We didn't go to church every Sunday. That's not how our parents raised us. We were from Generation X. The first generation to have two working parents in the home. We were lone wolves. Generation Xers, we have a couple. Yeah. We did it ourselves. We were lone wolfers. So what did we do in high school, both of us, as we start talking? We went to youth groups with a lot of our friends in high school, tried out different churches, you know. Hey, let's see what this Mormon thing is. Hey, let's see what this Catholic thing is. Hey, let's see what the Baptists do. Let's see what these people do. So we tried out different things. So we always had a moral compass, I guess, but never really a good, strong relationship. So when we became parents, we're like, we're going to church. And we're sitting in worship at Hillside. A friend of mine was going there, so I'm like, hey, we're just going to go with you. Isn't that how you find churches usually? Hey, I'm just going to go with you. And I remember distinctly in worship, Ryan going, check this out, look, and put your hand right here. And this little girl, we didn't know she was a little girl then because we were going to be surprised, but she's doing flips, right? And that was just cool. We're like, okay, that's cool. You feel a baby, whatever. And then the next Sunday, hey, check this out. And she's doing flips. Hey, check this out. Every Sunday, this girl is just flipping in her belly, right? Every Sunday. So I'm like, oh, maybe she just likes the music. Maybe it's this. But we're like, wow, how crazy this. You can hear the songs of worship that this baby's doing these flip-flops. And we knew we're in the right place and that God is going to bless this baby of ours, who's not a baby anymore. So my testimony here today and to the witnesses in front of me and Ryan, that while she was pregnant, life begins in the womb, people.
Amen.
Life begins in the womb. And it's segueing to where we're going today in this discussion, in the sense of we're going to get away from society and get back to Christ. Life begins in the womb. There's absolutely no doubt about it. Okay? Yeah. And the science proves it too. So I don't care how you feel. You got to get away from feelings and get back to facts. And got to get away from feelings and get back to Christ. Okay? So life begins in the womb. And I'm not ashamed to say it. And we need to not be ashamed to say it. All right. Oh, wait, Jeremiah 1:5. Then the word of the Lord came to me, saying, before I formed you in the womb, I knew you. Thank you. Before you were born, I sanctified you. So you start realizing that God's told us the whole time that I knew you in the womb. Life doesn't, they're not clumps of cells. That's life. Life begins then. So when I say I became a father in November of 2003, that's when we were notified that there was a life in her womb. She wasn't born till July. I didn't become a father until July. I didn't become an earthly father till July, but she was born and began being conceived in November. Then in December 2005, our son was born, so now I'm a father. No, I'm a father before then. Okay, well, what does that mean? I didn't have a dad. Hey, Dad, how'd you do this? Hey, Dad, how'd you do?
Well, we used to smoke cigars when our baby was.
No, okay. I didn't have any reference of what do I do. So fortunately, we were going to church, and so it became a big biblical journey. And I kind of say becoming a father is what helped me become a Christian, because I needed to be a better person. I needed to figure out what was right and how to bring them up properly. So becoming a father led me on my biblical journey. I needed to learn how to be a better man, to be guided by and mentored by someone greater and more experienced than me. Anybody have anybody more experienced or greater than God? If you do, let me know. But, and I would say you're probably talking to the wrong God, but there's nobody better, right? Because Ryan and I, we always used to say, there's no instruction book for raising a kid, right? Anybody have the instruction book? Dr. Spock and all that, right?
No.
There's an instruction book. There's an instruction book. When I was preparing for this service today, and I type in Father's Day quotes, sermons, I think I found over 35 different verses just on fathers. Okay, there's an instruction book, but we don't read it enough. We don't pick it up enough. Our culture hasn't adopted enough. Our culture is getting away from it enough. Okay, too much. So there is an instruction book. And it's not like, what do I do when I want to hit my kid? But it's close, okay? It's not that kind of instruction book, but it'll get you there. I'll get to hitting kids at the end of the sermon. Be patient. I get there. So we used to say, you know, what do we do when we get it wrong? Trust me, we got a lot wrong. I guarantee my kids are going to need therapy at some point. I pray it's not as much as some of those other kids, but, they're going to need therapy. I get it. There's an instruction book. We know it's not on Amazon. It's right here. Let me get Amazon. We need to talk to him to get our guidance.
Yeah.
So I think for years people are like, oh, that's so sad you lost your dad at seven. But I think God was teaching me, you don't need that. I'm here for you. And I'm like, oh, okay. Well, thanks for telling me when I'm 40-something years old instead of when I'm this age, right? But how many of us have earthly fathers? You don't have to raise your hands. How many of us have earthly fathers that have failed us? Every hand should go up, because I guarantee as a dad, how many dads have failed their kids, right? We fail on a daily basis. It doesn't have to be a big failure. It could be a little failure, but we fail on a daily basis. Ask my kids. So who do we go for guidance? We pray about it. Well, you can't just pray and say, hey, can you make this go away? It's a relationship that we have with God, and then he begins to speak with us. And then how do we have that relationship? Because we're reading scripture daily, because we're in the word, because we're talking to him on a daily basis. We're driving down the street going, hey, you know what's on my heart. Can you help? Hey, this is what I got going today. Can you direct me in the right? So, and it's a constant, ongoing conversation.
Right.
And it's a relationship. I sometimes talk to God more than I talk to my wife sometimes. Truly, right? If I'm not with her or it's via text or I'm teaching or I'm working, there's just different relationships. And soundly, when I'm talking to him more, my life is going better. When I'm getting too busy and I'm not talking to him enough, my life is struggling. It's stressful. There's challenges in my marriage. There's challenges with my kids. But when I'm in the word and when I'm in a conversation with God, it's better. And that's my father. And you're like, okay, well, that's weird. People have always talked about this heavenly father thing. Yeah, I don't get it. Until you start reading. Until you start talking to him. Until you start having that relationship. And then you're like, I get it. All right. I mean, I'm a new Christian, right? When she was doing flips in the womb, I was like, worship, hands in pockets, right, dads? Hands in pockets, right? I'm now about right here, right, as a Christian, right? There's an evolution, is there not, right? Some of y'all, I'm respecting you right here. I'm like, yeah, I'm not there yet. I'm not going to lie. I'm here, still here, okay? But when she was in the womb, I'm still, yep, just like this, you know? So there's an evolution. Well, having that relationship with God is an evolution as well. Okay, trust me, it doesn't happen overnight. Trust me, and you're gonna backslide. He's gonna correct you, and he's gonna yell at you at times. Don't have God yell at you. It sucks. It's not a good day. So this week, while I'm praying, going, okay, I don't have a true testimony to a dad. I really don't. I can't say, man, my dad took me fishing all the time, and he taught me this, taught me how to tie knots. I'm still learning how to do this stuff, right? So what do you want me to talk about? I looked through some verses, and there was 2 Corinthians 6:11-18 just screams out at me. I think it's more 14-18, but we're going to cover that today. So where I wanted to go is I wanted to break down some scripture. So as we read 2 Corinthians, should be 2 Corinthians, but that's it. That's right there, 11-18, okay? Paul's talking to the Corinthians. If we know anything about the Corinthians, which I did a little bit of research and found out they're bad people, but they're not bad people because they actually look a lot like us. So we read scriptures, flip to 2 Corinthians 6:11. Oh, Corinthians, I've spoken openly to you. Our heart is wide open. You're not restricted by us, but you're restricted by your own affections. Now in return for the same, I speak to you as children, you also be open. Do not be unequally yoked together with unbelievers, for what fellowship has righteousness and lawlessness? And what communion has light with darkness? And what accord has Christ with Belial? Or what has a believer with an unbeliever? And what agreement has the temple of God with idols? For you the temple of the living God. And God had said, I will dwell in them. I will walk among them. I will be their God. And they shall be my people. Therefore, here comes a commandment. Come out from among them and be separate, says the Lord. Don't touch what is unclean, and I will receive you. I will be a father to you, and you shall be my sons and daughters, says the Almighty. I know she was probably flipping through really quick because I was probably talking too fast. Now I want to break it down. Oh, get out of this. Hold on. Oh, well, I don't know how to do it. I made some corrections. Go to the next slide. What if Paul's talking to us? Oh, bitter rooters, we've spoken to you openly. Our heart is wide open for you. You are not restricted by us, the Trinity. Okay, that's what he's talking about. You're not restricted by us. You're restricted by your own affections. Ow, what is that? Who's your favorite football team? Those Atlanta Falcons? Those Pittsburgh Steelers? How about hockey? Those Pittsburgh Penguins I've heard about? Are those our own affections? Is it work? Are we putting too much time into work and not into God? Are we putting time into porn and not into our wife? What are our own affections, okay? It's pulling us away from Christ, okay? Is it Instagram? Is it Facebook? How many stories can you put on Instagram a day? How much of that time could you be putting into the Word? Right? We are pulling ourselves away. God never left. He never changed. We're pulling ourselves away. Okay? Do not be unequally yoked together with unbelievers. Ooh, that's a deep one. So what fellowship has righteousness with lawlessness, and what communion has light with darkness, and what accord has Christ with Belial, or what part has a believer with an unbeliever? Stop right there. Who's Belial? Good, I had to look it up too. How many of us read through the scripture and we don't understand, so we keep going, right? Well, then I'm like, I'm on stage, I should probably know what this guy is. This guy is bad. This guy, I'm gonna scroll up, is the personification of wickedness and evil. Belial appears to be a spirit or personification of evil through people as Christians. The personification of evil through people as Christians. Hey man, just have another drink with me. Hey man, just try this line. Hey man, don't worry about it. Your wife's not here. Hey man. How many of us have Christian friends like that? How many of us have friends that are not Christian like that, pulling us away? Well, I want to be cool, and I want to be fit in, so I maybe get straight off. Hey, man, check this out I just saw. Hey, check this post out. The personification of evil through people as Christians. We're not sons and daughters of the Heavenly Father when we're going that way, okay? But those who do not belong to Christ are the sons and daughters of the father of lies, the sons and daughters of Belial, okay? What's the new way to think? Hey, I feel this is what I am, right? Ooh, I feel I love this person more than I love this person that I'm committed to. I feel I want to be a girl today. I feel, right? I knock that word a lot out of my daughter's mouth sometimes because she'll come home from public education. I feel, I don't care, babe, what's happening? And I do care, and she laughs at me. She's like, well, I just want you to listen to me. I get it. I care how you feel, but that's not always what's happening. That's not what's going on. How you feel about something is not true, right? Just because you feel a certain way is not true. And we as Christians need to be firm in our faith and stand up against that. Society is saying it's okay. The Corinthians were saying this was okay. That's why I say, oh, Bitterrooters. We're allowing it to happen in our valley here. One of the most conservative places in Montana. One of the most conservative places in this nation. And I will tell you, our schools are absolutely infiltrated with this stuff right now. So, don't be unequally yoked with one another. Some people interpret that as, hey, we can't hang around with other people that aren't Christians. How many people know that? Do we have Amish in this community? We do, right? What's their belief? I think it's largely on this verse. They don't hang around with other Christians. They stay in their community, right? There are other Christian communities that do the same thing. I can't hang out with other Christians. Is that what Jesus believes? What did Jesus do? Yeah, let's hang out with some sinners. Let's hang out with some prostitutes. Let's hang out with those tax collectors and those drunkards, right? I think there's somewhere in the gospel that says, go out and make disciples, right? I think it's called the Great Commission. So I don't believe he wants us to not live in our society. I think he believes he doesn't want us to live for that society. We need to stand up and say, life begins in the womb. We need to stand up and say, no, you're not identifying as that. You're either a boy or a girl. That's just how it's in the Bible, and science proves it. So let's stick with facts, people. And that's what Jesus wants us to do. That's what I think he's reading there when he's saying, don't be unequally yoked. He talks more about, what does that really mean? Well, what's a yoke? Does anybody know what a yoke is? What's a yoke? Yeah. Yeah. So how's that parallel come? If you didn't hear him, he says, it's a thing that goes between two oxes. If you have one ox that's too strong and one ox too weak, you're going down the street like this, okay? So if you have a marriage and one's a Christian and one's not, you're going to have a problem? When we start talking about where this comes from, what does it mean to be equally yoked? Same mission, same values, same goals. If your mission as husband and wife is different, you're going to have some challenges. If we're going to raise our kids Jewish, No, we're going to raise them Christian. You're going to have some challenges, okay? If you love somebody else instead of this person, you're going to have some challenges. If you are not equally yoked as a couple, we have challenges, right? That's what it's talking about. It's talking about coming together, living for Christ, choosing those things. The city of Corinth was a powerhouse for immorality. It was riddled with different temples for gods and goddesses. They would go to temples and have prostitution in their temples and orgies in their temples. Probably some pedophilia in their temples. America's going that way as well. I'm not sure if you guys are picking up on a lot of what's going on. Well, the Supreme Court said, I don't care what the Supreme Court said. That doesn't mean it's legal. That doesn't mean God says it's okay. Okay? So even if our society continues to go that way, what's the road is wide? The road is wide, but the gate is narrow, right? We need to be on this narrow course. Does that mean I don't have gay family members? Does that mean I don't have gay friends? No. I have gay family members. I have gay friends, and I love them. Okay? I don't love their lifestyle. Okay? And I will continue to talk to them in a Christian way and say, hey, these are your choices. You know, not every time I see them because I love them and I don't want to have an adversarial relationship with them all the time, right? But it doesn't mean you accept and love their sin, right? You can still be the light that God needs you to be to them, right? Okay. Let's go to verse 16. And what agreement has the temple of God with idols? I'm not sure if you guys remember. For you are the temple of the living God. Yes. Look at me, people. God created this temple. I ain't ashamed. I am in the mirror, but remember, God created you. You are the temple of God, okay? So, and that's hard for us because we're so critical of ourselves, right? Because Instagram doesn't look like that. Facebook doesn't look, Snapchat doesn't look like that. We're comparing ourselves to everybody else. You are wonderfully and beautifully made. Some of us walk with a limp. Some of us have tremendous back pain. Some of us have disabilities. Some of us has disabilities on the inside that you can't see. Some of us have all the above. But you're beautifully and wonderfully made. It says it right here in the scripture, for you are the temple of the living God. Sit on that for a second. Accept that. I get goosebumps. I will dwell in them and walk among them. This is God speaking. Now, this is what God says. As God has said, I will dwell in them and walk among them. I will be their God. That's what he says. Because the Corinthians were worshiping these other idols, what were they called? What were the female prostitute goddesses back then? I can't think. But they were worshiping everything but God. Or maybe God and all these other things. I would offer we're kind of doing the same thing. How much time are you spending on Instagram and Facebook? How much time are you worshiping to that conservative newscast that's telling you all the terrible things that's going on in the world? How much time are you spending, right? Are we not worshiping that as well? So I think God speaking, he is the same. He hasn't changed. These words ring true today as they did back then. And they shall be my people. Here's the therefore. What happens after therefore in the Bible? It tells you what to do. How many of y'all like being told what to do? My wife loves it. Anybody? She loves telling me, but who likes being told what to do? Right? Don't tell me what to do. Oh, get it. Okay. From 5 years old, my kid said that. That's normal. But this is God. And he says, therefore, come out from among them. He wanted them out of the temples that were praying to these priestesses. That's what the word I was looking for. There's these priestesses, okay, that were talking, hey, come have sex with me. That's what will get you to heaven. Come out from that. And be separate, says the Lord. It is not politically correct for me to stand up here and say that abortion is wrong. It's not politically correct for me to say that homosexuality, transgenderism is wrong, okay? I know some of you know that I'm in certain political offices. It's not politically correct, but when we put Jesus first, I don't care. Amen. And you shouldn't either. If you're living for Christ, you shouldn't either. Is it going to get you fired from your job? No. Might it? Yeah. There's a guy in Washington that was praying with this football team, and it's at the Supreme Court. I don't know if they made that decision yet on that one yet, but it might. But I'd much rather be cool with Jesus than to be cool with my neighbor. Amen. Just saying, right? And trust me, if that he loses that job, another door opens. Amen. My daughter and I have that conversation all the time. I wanted this. I know, God's got something else planned for you. And then something happened, and she's like, I'm so happy now. I go, I know, it's crazy. Crazy. Like, God knows more than you. And I get to preach to her because I didn't have somebody at 18 telling me that same stuff. I was like, yeah, I know everything. I'm doing everything I want to do. And she at least gets the wonderful blessing of a father who gets to remind her that you don't know everything and it's not going to be perfect all the time. But God has a greater plan for us, okay? If you come out from among them and be separate. That's harder. It's easier to say than to do. I get that. I do. I get that. Be weird. Be weird. Craig Groeschel wrote a book called Weird. Okay? I know some of us don't like to read books. Awesome. One of the best Christian books I read. Because what it talks about is being weird. Okay? Is it weird to come up and go, hey, Beth, how are you doing today? And just come across the room, somebody you don't know. Is it weird to be outspoken to say, hey, abortion's not right. Hey, come here. Why don't we go through this pregnancy and see if we can adopt this baby? Is it weird? Is it weird to say homosexuality is a sin? I love you, okay, but that's a sin. A lot of us have that feeling, but we don't want to be weird. We want to fit in with society. The basic premise of the book is if you're fitting in with society, you're not living for Jesus. If you're stepping out and being weird, like putting your hands up in worship and, no, I'm just kidding. That's normal. But why aren't we doing it? Because it's weird, right? And so only a couple of us are doing it. True, right? I'm convicting myself in that same statement. I'm still right here. My daughter's like, why are you clapping your finger? That's all I can do right now. That's all I can do. So be weird. We want to fit in so much with society, but that's not what Jesus said. What happens? Everybody wants to fit in with society. Now look where our country's going, okay? What if we went back to Jesus? I'm just saying. Like, we got out of schools years ago. What if we went back? Yeah, maybe ours. Like, it's not about elected leaders. There's corruption on both sides. It's about, let's get back to Jesus, okay? Can I change the country? Can I change Washington, D.C.? No, I don't have nuclear weapons. But can we change the Bitterroot? Can we change this church? Can we change our schools one school at a time? There are a lot of teachers in here that are doing great things, okay? They're under peer pressure because all their peers are, nah, maybe not Christians or maybe crazy. No, I'm just kidding. But there's peer pressure in schools, okay? But our teachers have a great influence there. Start. Well, separation of church and state. Yeah, but you can still be the light. You can still walk. And the separation of church and state is a whole other discussion I'll have with you. It doesn't apply. It's not really true. Be a Christian. All right, enough of that. Do not touch what is unclean, and I will receive you. I will be a father to you, and you shall be my sons and daughters. Many of us who had earthly fathers may have had a terrible relationship with our dad. We may have had a dad who wasn't there. Maybe he was working too much because he was trying to provide. Maybe he was out philandering with girls and he was never home. Maybe he just wasn't there. He died when you were 7, okay? Maybe you had the best dad in the world and he was taking you fishing every day, but I guarantee you still probably made mistakes. Maybe you had a dad that didn't love us enough, didn't wrap their arms around us and tell much how special they were and how I love you and you can do anything, son, okay? Everybody has daddy issues. Everybody has mommy issues. It's just at what level, okay? But we have a father who loves us unconditionally. And those of us that are parents, do you love your kids unconditionally? I hate it. I hate no matter what they do wrong, I still love them, okay? But that doesn't even compare to how God loves us, right? So you're like, wow. Skipping through all that. There's a few verses in a few songs, and I'm closing up. I know, we're getting long. Newsboys, your love never fails. Nothing can separate. Even if I run away, your love never fails. I know I've made some mistakes, but you stay the same through the ages. It's true. This verse that I've read today was true 2,000 years ago, and it's true today in the Bitterroot. He needs us to step out of our societies and come to him. Who am I? This verse, Stacy, why? Who am I? I'm a terrible father. Why would you want me to talk today? Casting crowns. I love casting crowns. Who am I? It's very convicting to me all the time. Who am I that the Lord of all the earth would care to know my name, would care to feel my hurt, would choose to light the way for my ever wandering heart? What? I'm a Christian. I don't have a wandering heart. Yeah, we all do. Every day, whatever that is. Not because of who I am, but because of what you've done. Not because of what I've done, but because of who you are. Wow. I think that's why I don't like worship, because I cry too much in worship, because those words are so convicting. It doesn't matter what. Yeah, it's just a challenge for me. Themes I want you to take away from today. Be weird. Be weird.
I don't want to be weird. I want to grow a beard and be a Montana.
Yes. It's weird. This is my spring beard. I gotta get my tan. I'll grow it back in the fall. And by being weird, we're following God's command. Come out from among them and be separate, says the Lord. Right? To discuss that all day. Love. Ooh, what's that mean as a father? Sometimes love's hard for us as dads.
Oh, we gotta be tough. Can't do this.
No, you can be tough. Okay? We can wrap our arms around our sons and tell them I love you. Okay? You may not have got that as a son, but we can do that, and we can change things, and we can heal hearts, okay? Sometimes love equals discipline. There's several verses, especially in Proverbs, that say, do not withhold correction from a child, for if you beat him with a rod, he will not die.
God's telling me. I'm just saying. Proverbs 23:13.
But apparently that's wrong, and we've gotten away from that in society. How's our society looking? How many of our kids probably needed some correction when they were younger and we didn't hit them, right? Millennial? I'm sorry. I'm just kidding, millennials. But using that analogy of a rod, we need to correct our children, our grandchildren. We need to have that ability to steer them back in the right direction, okay? That's an important, but society tells us no. I'm gonna go back to the first one. Be weird. That's okay. I've hit my kids. I'm not denying it. I will testify before a judge. I've hit my kids, okay? But they turned out like this now. And I haven't had to hit them in about 6 or 7 years. But when they were, I only had to hit her once. Jake's been a little bit more. Not gonna lie. But even then, he's a really good boy as well, right? Our young parents in here, don't be afraid to hit them and correct them, okay? What I learned, so testimony-wise, what I learned as a father, don't hit him in anger. Hit him in correction. I did that once and then never do it again. Don't hit him in anger. When you're angry, walk away and then come back and correct him, because that sucks. That's the worst feeling. Because we're just too hard on it. Forgiveness. As we have all been forgiven. The verse, I don't think it's up there. Children, obey your parents in the Lord, for this is right. Maybe it is. Honor your father and mother. This is the first commandment with a promise, that it may go well with you and you may live long on the earth. Ephesians 6:1. It's all biblical. If we looked at the rule, if we looked at the instruction book a little bit more, okay, it's in there, okay? I'm backtracking. I'm like, oh, I did that. And look, there's a verse that says this, okay? Now I'm starting, if I just start reading it and I start applying it to my life more. Be the example. Be the light. We hear that all the time. Be the light of the world. Be the hands and feet of Jesus. Be the example. As a father, what do you want your children to grow up to be? Be that example, okay? Therefore, come out from among them and be separate, says the Lord. Do not touch what is unclean. Be the example. Be weird. Be the example to your coworker. Step out. Be weird. And lastly, I want you to walk away with, he knew us in the womb. Don't give in to society's pushes. Don't be popular. Be the Christian man God commands us to be. Many of us in this room are dealing with fatherly issues. Many of us had a terrible relationship with our father. Many of us may be estranged from our fathers. Many of us may be estranged from our sons and daughters and don't talk to them. Forgive. Call them. Today, when you get out of church, call your mom. Sorry. Call your dad. Call your son and daughter that you haven't talked to because you think they're mad at you. Okay? Call them. Talk to them. Tell them that you love them. Okay? They want to hear it. They want to see it. I love you all. Have a great Sunday.
respond in our own hearts to the Lord, whatever he spoke to us personally from the message. And so you're welcome to stand and sing, or you can sit and pray, whatever you need to do to respond to the Lord in the next few minutes.
Lay your blazing there.
John. Okay. So, as Matt spoke, he brought sometimes a tough word. And if it offended you, send your email to buckrodoff@yahoo.com. No. Actually, sometimes we can be kind of shaken in at times where it's like, yeah, that kind of great to be wrong, but now's the time to ask the Holy Spirit if you've allowed culture to get into your life. Because we all have. We've all let culture get into what we believe, as opposed to the truth that is in here. And Jesus was always counterculture. He still loved. Like Matt pointed out, he still loved deeply. He still loved the people around him in a deep way. And I said once before that Paul was actually martyred not because he was a Christian and spoke about Jesus. He was actually martyred because he was considered a hater of people, because he spoke against the culture of the time. And when you say homosexuality is wrong, or changing your gender is wrong, we're automatically considered haters. But it's important for us as Christians to not hate, but to love and embrace those people. We don't have to embrace the lifestyle, but out of love, we need to reach out to them, because we know what that lifestyle leads to. It leads to not heaven, but it leads to destruction. So I just want to pray for us. Matt, thank you for bringing that word. Please do not hit your children. You can spank them. But it is great to spank your children, but not hit them, okay? Let's just make that clear. I wanted to...
Clarification.
That radio announcement says the news and opinions have just spoken, or not the news... No, just kidding. Sorry. No. Oh, Father, thank you for your word that convicts us, that leads us to love, that leads us to being more like Christ. Lord, help us to understand that balance of loving deeply our neighbor or that person that we're friends with, but separating that from the lifestyle. Lord, help us to not worship the idols that we worship in our lives, whether that be social media, whether that be a hobby or something that gives us joy. Help us not to put that on a pedestal above you, but help us to only worship you with all that we are. Lord, I thank you so much for your word that's the instruction booklet book of our lives, Lord. Help us to dive in. Help us to understand. Help us to embrace. And help us to follow, Lord. Lord, we just thank you for your love. Thank you that you are a good, good Father. And that you love us deeply and dearly. That we're loved by you. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Amen. Everyone have a great, great, blessed Father Day.